Evening. This is the final day of excellent week of programming around non-personal data that HasGeek has been convening. And I'm just here very quickly to introduce the first speaker this evening. For the next sort of hour and 20 minutes, we have first Srikanth talking to us about this particular concept around a debt and NPD that he's going to be talking more about. And then for about 15, 20 minutes, following which within that 20 minute slot by 6:20, I'm going to provide some reactions to his presentation and invite comments. We'll have a short break, and at 6:30, then we'll begin moderated discussion around privacy concerns in non-personal data, the V2 of the report, with an excellent lineup of panelists who will introduce themselves. So given we're quite short and snappy with time, I'm going to go off video and hand over to Srikanth to take us through his presentation. Thanks, Srikanth.
Thanks, Malvika. Hello, everyone. I'm Srikanth, part of Cashless Consumer, a consumer collective on digital payments. What we'll be looking today is around the topic of debt, NPD, and ownership checking infrastructure. Now, I'll unbundle each of these as we go through the presentation. A quick overview of what we are planning to cover over the next 20 odd minutes. These are essentially political economy observations, looking at payment systems and other data flows in them. Specifically, we'll be looking at three payment systems, Bharat Bill Payment System, FASTag, and National Common Mobility Card. We'll see what the non-personal data aspects of these payment systems. And the emphasis here is not on privacy, so that's a separate debate we've kind of had through all the privacy conversations, and there are probably enough literature by now on privacy issues around each of these. So I'll not touch much upon the privacy aspects of these, but we'll focus on the NPD aspects, so which is the non-personal data. So on that, much is touted on the economic value of non-personal data. And even if you've seen the reports, there is a economic growth aspect of non-personal data that keeps coming around. We'll kind of see that slightly closer with these real world examples. So for that, what we try to do is we'll see This whole notion of NPD has come around in, let's say, 2020, when this committee was formed, and then it produced two versions of the report, which we are discussing through the week. But we'll kind of see how this essentially non-personal data was still kind of managed on these three payment systems, and for which we kind of see what's also common is all these three payment systems are essentially part of the indebted infrastructure sector. So you might have heard in the news about the non-performing assets of banks and so on. It's basically the loans that are not coming up, and these are primarily on the infrastructure sector. And when we say infrastructure sector, one is electricity. That's where BBPS will come in, and we'll go through what it is. Next is FASTag, which is where all your highways and tollways come in. And then the third is National Common Mobility Card, which is where all the infrastructure around your metros, metro rails in urban context comes in. And we see how all these three have been having huge debt issues over their financing of infrastructure and what these systems and the NPD around them try to achieve, and what where we are today. We'll kind of see a brief overview. And then we'll kind of use this knowledge as a background and see what NPD is, because mostly you've kind of seen NPD from the prism of, let's say, startups or us as communities generating data, or wanting access to data. But we'll kind of see what NPD is through the lens of the state, or what NPD entitles to the state, and what we should be worrying about. And as always, standard disclaimer, views are personal and of course political as well. You may agree or disagree with me. So we'll get started. So first is power sector. what is the role of BBPS and NPD? So a brief history of power sector reforms in India. I think ever since we've kind of opened up our economy, there is a significant push in privatizing the power sector, which is traditionally held by the state, both the, the various forms of it, so be it generation, transmission, or distribution. And there were initial set of reforms which kind of uncoupled each of these functions and said we've kind of largely allowed a range of private sector players in the generation aspect, and in some cases, transmission and distribution as well. Although distribution is still held largely by the state, the individual state governments own the electricity company. And what kind of and that has also led to some kind of a financial crisis in them, which is why you kind of you might have heard these names, Udai scheme, and that was kind of put in place somewhere in the NDA one, which is to kind of bring these distribution companies to a better financial health, relieving them of their excessive debt burden. And one aspect of it is, and which we are now seeing as part of the Atmanirbhar Bharat, is the DISCOM privatization. And we'll kind of closely see what's the role of NPD in all these. So one problem is essentially, so we've kind of seen one part of this puzzle is that DISCOMs are unable to collect electricity bills. And so collections have been a problem, which is kind of leading them to a place where they are financially unhealthy. So there has been multiple committees and task forces thinking around solving these problems. So the initial, the earliest reference to that is the 2002 Power Sector IT Task Force, which kind of suggested computerization of the consumer information system as well as bill collection system. So the earlier versions of, say, digitization of these, so to bring in efficiencies and see improve them. And then slightly later in the day, RBI came up with this concept of a bill payment system. And in 2013, it kind of floated this idea again. And what it essentially meant through that regulation was to create an infrastructure where RBI mandated all bill utility bill payments to be centrally routed through this system called Bharat Bill Payment System. So this is basically, so if you have kind of a brief history on payment systems on utilities, is essentially you would kind of be going to the counter and paying up in cash or probably a website of this utility company. That kind of changed over, last 3-4 years when, since Bharat Bill Payment System has gone live, you might have seen your DISCOM getting listed in your favorite app, payment app, and then you could just pay your electricity bills. That's possible because of BBPS, and BBPS is mandated regulatorily by RBI. What BBPS also does is basically creates a centralized data stores of all the receivable data of all the DISCOMs. So essentially, we can practically say that every electricity bill in India is being centralized in this BBPS data store. And this, of course, does have its own personal data implications. I'm not going to go into that. We're only going to see the non-personal data implications of that. So on the non-personal data front, how can this data be leveraged? So one is, as part of this privatization, they are planning to kind of use this data and run some data analytics and then see how we can kind of segregate our DISCOM companies into more efficient units and then privatize them. So let's say today your one big state has one single distribution company. Now, how can each city have its own distribution companies and how can they be privatized individually? So that they can, their value can be maximized and so on. So this is one place where this data, let's say the receivables data of DISCOMs is being used. So this will probably go into valuation of these, bidding of these DISCOMs and so on. Let's say in the other, why is the focus on, say, digitizing DISCOM data? The other reasoning is also that there is a huge transmission and distribution loss in kind of distributing power. So if we have better knowledge as to what the consumption patterns are down to the, let's say, street transformer, then they can optimize, the distribution companies can optimize their networks and then use and deploy their infrastructure effectively to kind of save load. And they can, say, analyze consumption patterns across various regions or areas in the city, and then they can kind of manage their network efficiently. So that's the other role of non-personal data in say, power. And what we've done through BBPS is essentially, we've kind of centralized this data infrastructure at a national scale. So BBPS, as with any other payment system, is being run by the National Payments Corporation of India, which you might have known that it's a bank-owned settlement infrastructure company that's collectively owned by a set of banks. There's also been some recent discussions around forking off a subsidiary for BBPS. Now, this all discussion is of importance because if you see the value that NPCI, which itself is a nonprofit, has and is only data. And this data is not just the personal data of, say, you and me using UPI or any other payment system, but it is also this non-personal data that forms a crucial role. And that is forking that off to a different entity. One kind of needs to see who benefits out of it. We'll leave the who benefits out of this just for your thinking. And I want to kind of bring in the NPD paper context here. So the NPD paper context here is essentially a data trustee. I mean, if you read through the NPD report, you notice the data trustee being referred. And here data trustee kind of aggregates the NPD of the entire, let's say, sector. So this, say, subsidiary for the BBPS would kind of own this NPD of all the power distribution companies. Now, we'll see what's the issue with that towards the end. Now, this is power sector. And then we have a similar set of issues on road infrastructure and FASTag, why we are having FASTag as. So again, brief history of highway development in India. There have been like multiple PPP modes of building highways ever since, say, the golden quadrilateral days and so on. But even that sector again faced significant financial health issues, which means that, say, the contractors who were putting the highways were not getting compensated, or the state was losing out a lot more money. Tolls were not collected properly. So FASTag was kind of again conceptualized as an electronic tolling system, which will kind of maximize the revenues of. So just like how in the power sector, we had a collection problem. So even in the highway sector, the tolling was again a problem. And FASTag was kind of pushed as a technological solution. It was conceptualized in 2010. There was a committee report and it went through multiple iterations and kind of fully went live in 2020 and is now mandatory in 2021. Again, FASTag has its own, say, the privacy issues. We're not going to go into that, but let's quickly see how the NPD role of FASTag data is. Now, FASTag kind of collects, let's say, the traffic volume of each highway systemically, and with which, let's say, the traffic volumes across individual highway segments can be measured in very absolute terms, because especially if you make FASTag as a mandatory mode of payment for tolling, you are basically having the entire tolling infrastructure data in a single place. And if you strip off the personal data part, you'll be having a rich NPD data set, which is then further used to decide policy. And the policy here in the road infrastructure has been like two financing options. So one is called a model called toll operate transfer, where publicly funded highways, which is basically highways built with the government money, or in some cases, if let's say a highway was built by a private player, but the concessionaire agreement had completed over 20 years, now that kind of that highway comes into the hands of state. And then state decides to monetize that asset, the highway as an asset. And while monetizing that asset, the state is using these FASTag data to kind of value what the highway is and what its potential is. And then it puts a base price upon which multiple people bid over that highways for tolling rights, and use that. And then they participate in an auction and they get the tolling rights, and then they continue to toll. And state gets a one-time monetized value of that asset. So state no longer owns that highway. Now the highway is kind of sold off. So that's where an NPD is crucial there in the context of pricing the bid. So how do you value a highway for a 20-year period? So the answer to that is state. I mean, one way is to use the FASTag data and then do some projections. The other is, again, InVITS, which is slightly a different variant of this, wherein an InVIT will kind of issue like a mutual fund, and people can buy InVITS off the market, and the entire highways will be owned by InVITS. Again, a set of highways will be transitioned into this trust, which will issue InVITS. So again, the role of NPD here is largely around pricing of these TOT and InVIT bids. And again, housing this data, currently it's housed with NPCI, which is implementing the FASTag ATC project, along with an infrastructure consortium, IHMCL. This again, bringing back to the NPD debate, these are the data trustees of this data set. Again, I leave the WHO benefits to you, and then come to urban mobility. So urban mobility, again, we have a similar set of financing issues over funding metros for each of these cities. And metros typically take a very long time period to kind of build the entire infrastructure, and then ticketing forms only a very low part of repayment to that kind of debt. So NCMC has been like ideated multiple times, started in 2010, conceptualized in 2012, launched multiple times in very different names. Previously, there was an entity called UTIITSL, which was owned by Ministry of Finance, which ran some common mobility cards. Currently, there is again another pilot by NPCI to do a common mobility card. So every now and then you will see a common mobility card. So the role of NPD here is involves on two fronts. So one is the standard things that we've seen on valuing what the economic value of it in terms of transactions. So how much would are people transiting, or how much are people consuming electricity or using the highway? Like how much are people using the transit infrastructure is one part. But this transit infrastructure data can also lead to, let's say, planning input into urban development and planning transit networks themselves. So where do you build the next metro line and so on and so forth? So this again, there is a huge value in this non-personal data, and then this NCMC kind of tries to centralize this data into, again, with NPCI, and I would say you're taking away the autonomy from the cities. I'll again leave the WHO benefits to you. So this has been the case with India and how India has kind of navigated through this over the last decade. But we'll kind of see some examples globally. So there is Saudi Arabian bill payment system, which is called SADAD, is being run by the Saudi Arabian banking regulator themselves. And it's a fully centralized data store. An NPD, much like the database itself, is with the regulator or the state. And I can loosely call it to, let's say, a Marxian model where the state owns all this data. And then there is Oyster Cards in London. So they have a Transport for London Authority, just a corporatized entity looking at all aspects of transportation in London. They again issue Oyster Cards, which is for the transit payments in London, which again creates a centralized data store which also generates NPD around transit patterns in London and so on. It's with this entity, TfL, but it's also TfL again rolls up to the London City Council and so on. And it's sort of, let's say, NPTE is accessible not just to the state, but largely to the community and the market as well. And I would say broadly, this equated with the Keynesian model. And then we'll take an example of tolling and toll interoperability in the US. So US also has a freeway system and multiple tolling, electronic tolling projects much before we've had. And there, again, there was a conversation recently, a few years back, around why do we need to have a tolling, e-tolling infrastructure uniquely, separately for each state? Why can't we have an interoperable tolling system? And there, the way they've solved it is not by having a single entity, but then used a federated interoperability standard with which, like, you can still move across multiple toll providers and still have different set of, you don't need to actually have multiple tags or transponders and can still transact in an interoperable way. And here the NPTE is kind of collected in a federated manner, as in whichever tolling company owns that particular highway kind of has its toll data. It's not shared with the state. It's so it's kind of NPTE is with the market. And I would kind of say, loosely say, this is an Adam Smith model of housing this NPTE data. And in India, we've just seen through BBPS, NCMC, and NETC, which is FASTag. We kind of have a slightly mixture of all these put together in one form or the other. Now, we kind of broadly see which are like the NPTE generator systems or high-value data sets systems currently available to kind of, before we see what NPTE what role NPTE plays. And I've kind of split this by ownership. So let's say the first generation systems or the legacy systems, we've had, say, Vahan, which is the vehicle data. You might have heard this in the context of privacy leaks or a Vahan data sharing framework and so on. And then we have, say, GSTN, which houses taxation data. PFMS has public finance data. ENAM is an agricultural market, but is basically run by the state. And then IMPDS is basically the ration shop network, which again houses both food consumption data as well as potentially migratory data as well. And then say we have eCourts, which houses all the litigation data, NCRB houses crime data. So this is all basically state-owned or state-built data infrastructures, which have a very high value data sets on NPD. Now there is, again, moving on, like there's a second category, which is regulator-owned or built data sets. Examples here would be like the insolvency information utility built by the IBBI or approved by the IBBI. Rohini is a database of all hospitals in the country run by the Insurance Information Bureau, which is again under the IRDAI. FOSCOS is basically all the is a system basically that has a database of all the food licensing related data. So all the FSSAI, which is the food safety and standards regulator in India, has a system called FOSCOS, which licenses all the packed foods and so on. And then let's say the TRAI, which monitors the internet and telecom infrastructure, has an app called MySpeed, which is to monitor all the internet speeds, and then it kind of houses that infrastructure in itself. So these are some of the HVD infrastructures built and owned.
Time there for you, Srikanth. We are coming up to time, so you have a couple more minutes as well. Okay.
And then we have like the privately owned built infrastructure. There we saw these three, but there are some more as well. What do I mean by asset-light sector control infrastructure? So we've kind of seen through 2010 through 2020, state built several data platforms, as we've seen in the examples, through a private entity to centralize sectoral data. And this centralization of sectoral data was used with a strategic intent in raising capital to offset debt. Why do I call NPD as an asset-light? Because here, the government, which is not, will not even be building that kind of a data infrastructure to generate that data. And it's also partially because government wants or doesn't want to kind of regulate the digital economy same way, but still want to have some amount of power or control of the economy. So What it means is basically anybody, what it brings through this NPD framework is a data trustee, which will kind of operate the data infrastructure to collect, manage data, and then that is accessible to the government for whatever reasons it wants. Now, what does NPD mean in this context? So NPD will also be an infrastructure insolvency resolution tool. So as you've seen, that these sectors were kind of indebted by a huge margin. So the state kind of decided to intervene, put in these data platforms, extract data, generate NPD out of through systems. And then the state is currently using that to kind of get out of the debt mess that it has created. Now, what it would potentially mean this with NPD is state will not even be building those systems, but state still has access to such kind of granular data, which can then be used to decide policy for each of these sectors. And this has significant impact for existing and new investments across sectors. So we've kind of seen only the infrastructure sector and how payment systems were kind of used to generate NPD for the infrastructure sector. What this also means is approaches to data minimization will be structurally discouraged. So the state says that you got to generate data. And if you are operating in a sector and the state comes and says, this is the data trustee and you have to share your data, you might, even as an industry, you might not want to actually even collect some data. But you would be forced to kind of collect that data and then give that NPD to the data trustee, because now the NPD framework demands such kind of data to be shared to the data trustee. So data minimization options will be kind of structurally discouraged. And then the other issue is around governance of data trustees. So the framework mentions of data trustees. Now, what is the governance norms of these data trustees, transparency, accountability provisions of these, and how it impacts individuals, businesses is something to worry about. And that is all I have. Thank you.
Great. Thanks a lot for that. Actually, that was a very, very quick and a nice overview of all the thoughts that you had. What I'm going to do very quickly is just wait to check if we have any questions. I don't think we do, which is great. We are right on time. I'll just share a couple of observations maybe, and then we can go straight into the next panel, if that's fine for everyone, in order to stay on time. So, I mean, just in terms of responding to the presentation, Shrikant, I thought it was very interesting. Some interesting dots connected for me that I hadn't previously thought about in that light. I think everybody's talking about this foundational question of whether at all the state can do this and monetize data in this way or set up a regulatory framework. But I think two or three specific things I want to call out is, one is this presentation, it started doing this. And I think if you're planning to write it up as a paper, it might be really helpful to just call out the fact that you're thinking about NPD in the context of asset monetization. So obviously with DPAM and all of that, there's this huge conversation around asset monetization that's happening. And I don't think they've really thought about it seriously in terms of how do you unlock intangible asset value from data, whether it's the NPD itself, or how do you use NPD for business intelligence, or when the government is figuring out how to, you know, auction off its assets or whatever DPAM does. I think that's something that it's in there, and I would love to see more about that maybe at a future presentation. I think the other question that it raised for me is, I would like to understand whether you're thinking about NPD in itself being valued, and, you know, in some sense that itself is the public asset, or are you just thinking of NPD being used in these kinds of valuation exercises? And I think why that distinction is important is because in the first, where NPD itself becomes valuable, then are we starting to think about it as public infrastructure of some sort that everybody is getting open access to? And then a whole new range of regulatory and other issues come up. But if we're only thinking of it as business intelligence, then of course you're essentially thinking, how can the government use this better, or how can private players like you had in your table use it better? And quickly, I guess the last thing I will say is just, I think there was a little bit around financing in there and a little bit around the regulatory, what's the intended impact of these, of this framework? Again, would love to have that kind of drawn out. I think you wanted to say something, and then we can go straight into the panel discussion actually.
Okay. So I don't consider the NPD as an asset in itself. What I meant as an asset-light infrastructure is basically For doing this, the state had to invest significant capital, political and economic capital, to build out these data infrastructures. So we've talked through these three. And it has taken a decade long. With NPD framework, what the state is kind of doing is, it's latching onto the industry and saying that we are not going to even build this out. We want you to give us data that we want, and then we will use that in policy making. So we are. So this is like going, the asset light framework is basically, you don't even have any asset or data infrastructure. And the only thing that you're putting in place is a NPD framework, which will kind of latch on to the existing data sets by various industry, community, whatever, by mandating this community data sharing. And this is just one view as to how the state could potentially view. I'm not saying this is the, this is how the state intends to, or this is what the policy intends to, but this is possibly one consequence of the NPD framework.